Today's Bible reading comes from Lamentations chapter 3. I am the man who has seen affliction under the rod of his wrath. He has driven and brought me into darkness without any light. Surely against me he turns his hand again and again the whole day long. He has made my flesh and my skin waste away. He has broken my bones. He has besieged and enveloped me with bitterness and tribulation. He has made me dwell in darkness like the dead of long ago. He has walled me about so that I cannot escape. He has made my chains heavy. Though I call and cry for help, he shuts out my prayer. He has blocked my ways with blocks of stones. He has made my paths crooked. He is a bear lying in wait for me, a lion in hiding. He turned aside my steps and tore me to pieces. He has made me desolate. He bent his bow and set me as a target for his arrow. He drove into my kidneys the arrows of his quiver. I have become the laughingstock of all peoples, the object of their taunts all day long. He has filled me with bitterness. He has sated me with wormwood. He has made my teeth grind on gravel and made me cower in ashes. My soul is bereft of peace. I have forgotten what happiness is. So I say, my endurance has perished. So has my hope from the Lord. Remember my affliction and my wanderings, the wormwood and the gall. My soul continually remembers it and is bowed down within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man that he bear the yoke in his youth. Let him sit alone in silence when it is laid on him. Let him put his mouth in the dust, there may yet be hope. Let him give his cheek to the one who strikes, and let him be filled with insults. For the Lord will not cast off forever. But though he cause grief, he will have compassion, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not afflict from his heart, or grieve the children of men. To crush underfoot all the prisoners of the earth, to deny a man justice in the presence of the Most High, to subvert a man in his lawsuit, the Lord does not approve. Who has spoken and it came to pass, unless the Lord has commanded it? Is it not from the mouth of the Most High that good and bad come? Why should a living man complain, a man, about the punishment of his sins? Let us test and examine our ways, and return to the Lord. Let us lift our hearts and hands to God in heaven. We have transgressed and rebelled, and you have not forgiven. You have wrapped yourself with anger and pursued us, killing without pity. You have wrapped yourself with a cloud so that no prayer can pass through. You have made us scum and garbage among the peoples. All our enemies open their mouths against us. Panic and pitfall have come upon us, devastation and destruction. My eyes flow with rivers of tears because of the destruction of the daughters of my people. My eyes will flow without ceasing, without respite, until the Lord from heaven looks down and sees. My eyes cause me grief at the fate of all the daughters of my city. I have been hunted like a bird by those who were my enemies without cause. They flung me alive into the pit and cast stones on me. Water closed over my head. I said, I am lost. I called on your name, O Lord, from the depths of the pit. You heard my plea. Do not close your ear to my cry for help. You came near when I called on you. You said, do not fear. You have taken up my cause, O Lord. You have redeemed my life. You have seen the wrong done to me, O Lord. Judge my cause. You have seen all their vengeance, all their plots against me. You have heard their taunts, O Lord, all their plots against me. The lips and thoughts of my assailants are against me all the day long. Behold their sitting and their rising. I am the object of their taunts. You will repay them, O Lord, according to the work of their hands. You will give them dullness of heart. Your curse will be on them. You will pursue them in anger and destroy them from under your heavens, O Lord. This is God's word.
Well, good day, everyone. And thanks to Julie for reading that Lamentations chapter 3. It's a long passage. So if you have your Bible with you, please keep it open. I will refer to some of the verses from time to time. It's a long passage, so I cannot read every single one of them during the sermon. But please keep your Bible open. We are at Lamentations chapter 3. Well, when I was in primary school, we had to be in bed by 8 p.m. However, MacGyver, now some of you might know MacGyver, a TV show called MacGyver, the old one, not the new one. MacGyver started at 8:30 p.m. on Thursdays. So we loved that show, but we had to be in bed, and we only had one TV, and it was in my parents' bedroom. So on Thursday evenings, we would pretend to be in bed by 8 p.m., and then around 8:30, we would sneak into my parents' bedroom, and my parents would still be looking after the shop by then. By the time my parents got back, the show would be over, so no issue there. However, one night, my mom happened to be home early. She found us watching TV past our bedtime. Lo and behold, we received the ministry of the feather duster. Now, if you don't know what it means, you are missing out. You know, the feather end of the feather duster is to remove dirt from surfaces, but the other end is to remove smirks from our faces. Now, looking back, I know I deserved all the whacking, every single one of them. I don't resent my parents at all. However, when it was being administered, I felt like my parents were against me. I felt like my parents didn't love me. You see, the book of Lamentations was a little bit like that as well. It's a bit like that, but much more severe. In chapters 1 and 2, Jeremiah was clear. The whole nation was clear that they were ransacked by the Babylonians' army because of their hundreds of years of rebellion against God. They knew what was coming. However, when it happened, it still felt excruciating. And that's what Prophet Jeremiah felt as he wrote Lamentations chapter 3. In fact, that's what he felt when he wrote the whole book of Lamentations. Now, looking back, I know my mom was not trying to crush me. She was actually for me. She wanted the best for me. Similarly, as Jeremiah turned his focus to God's character, he finds hope in the midst of his affliction. So as you read chapter 3, you will see this progression in Jeremiah's thought process, and it serves as an important principle for us to remember in times of our suffering, especially when we feel that God is against us. When I feel that God is against me, I remember what He is like, and I come to You, Lord, because You are for me. Now, I know the sentence doesn't flow naturally here, but I trust it will make more sense later. So let's unpack this together. Firstly, when I feel that God is against me, Jeremiah begins his third lamentation with this: I am the man who has seen affliction under the rod of His wrath. He has driven and brought me into darkness without any light. Surely against me He turns His hand, and again the whole day long. This is a man who clearly feels that God is against him. It is intensely personal. You see, in chapter 1, Prophet Jeremiah laments over the desolation of Jerusalem, and he uses the pronouns she and her a lot to refer to the city and his people and the people. In chapter 2, Prophet Jeremiah describes how God is behind this calamity, and the pronouns he and his are prominent in chapter 2 to refer to God himself. And now in Lamentations chapter 3, especially in verses 1 to 18, in addition to the third person, he or his, the first person pronouns, I, me, and my, appear in almost every verse. So the pain and suffering that were more corporate in chapter 1 and 2 have turned very personal in chapter 3. God is like an enemy pinning Jeremiah down on the floor. In verses 4 to 6, for example, Jeremiah says that his suffering is not just physical, it is also emotional, it is social. He felt choked and he felt lonely. And then in verse 7 to 9, Jeremiah feels hopelessly boxed in, and he senses that God does not even hear nor answer his prayer. In verses 10 to 12, Jeremiah portrays God as being out there waiting to harm him whenever, wherever he turns. And then in verses 15 to 18, Jeremiah feels bitter. There's no more peace left in his soul. Joy has fled from his heart, and all hope is lost. Friends, when we go through intense suffering, we cannot help but feel to some extent what Jeremiah is feeling here, that everything, everyone, and even God seems to be against us. Now, of course, the context of lamentation is quite specific. The suffering that Jerusalem went through was because of their hundreds of years of rebellion against God, was due to their years of disobedience. On the other hand, when we suffer, sometimes it is because of our sins, but at times it is not. However, regardless of the nature of our suffering, one thing we cannot say. If you look at the passage, if you look at this passage, in fact, or if you look at the whole Bible, we cannot say that God is a passive participant in our suffering. Now, how active he is, of course, is another big question. However, the Bible forbids us from saying that God has absolutely nothing to do with our suffering. You see, when we go through any suffering, we are so quick to say, to pray, God, please remove this suffering. God, please do miracles in our life. Now, it is not wrong to pray for God to remove our suffering. We pray that every Sunday. However, we must ask the question, why do we pray like that? Is it because we believe that our suffering is here and God is there and God has nothing to do with our suffering whatsoever? That our suffering and God are never aligned? That our suffering is never aligned with God's will for us? What if our suffering is actually part of God's will? What if God lovingly orchestrates it because of his great and loving purpose in our life? What if suffering is a small thread in God's grand, complex tapestry, a small puzzle piece in God's one gazillion piece puzzle? When we suffer, we pray that God will do a miracle in our life, and we should. When my dad was battling with cancer, I prayed for that hundreds of times, especially towards the end of his life. However, is it ever possible that our suffering is actually God's miraculous intervention in our life? Now, if you are going through suffering, this might be very hard to swallow, and I apologize, I know that. And the last thing I want to do is to push you further into your pain. However, the Bible bears witness to this tension. In Job chapter 2, verse 10, for example, Job said this to his wife, "You speak as one of the foolish women would speak. Shall we receive good from God, and shall we not receive evil?" In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. And in this chapter of Lamentation, verse 38, Jeremiah says, "Is it not from the mouth of the Most High that good and bad come?" Even in Hebrews chapter 12, the author says this, "It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline?" And the author of Hebrews was writing to Christians under persecutions by pagan authorities. But still, the author says that God is not a passive participant here. So could it be that the first step for us to make sense of our suffering is to not remove God entirely from the cause of our suffering? Could it be that the key for us to endure suffering is to acknowledge that God is not a passive participant in our suffering? Now, modern day people like us find this very difficult to accept. However, the Old Testament saints, the people in the Bible, had no issue attributing God as the one who ushered or even ordained their suffering. And strangely, this actually gives them hope in the midst of their suffering. In the Bible, what gives people, what gives hope to those who are suffering is not the alleviation of their suffering. Yes, of course, it does as well, but it's not the ultimate hope. What gives hope is not the fact that God is separated from the suffering. What ultimately gives them hope is the character of God who is behind their suffering. This is what happened to Joseph. This is what happened to David. This is what happened to Jonah, to Job, especially to Job. And this is what happens as well in Lamentations chapter 3. In the midst of his bitterness, and Jeremiah is not underplaying his bitterness here. In the midst of his bitterness, Jeremiah turns his attention to God's characters, which leads me to the next point. When I feel that God is against me, I remember what He is like. I remember what He is like. You know, when I was young, there was no official show and tell at school. But we had our own version of show and tell. We would show our thighs and our calves, and we tell stories. This is the cane mark from yesterday. This is the feather duster from the other day. And this is the comb mark, still fresh. My mom used to use her big comb to do that. But that's enough about me. What about you? You know, but that was Indonesia, and that was in 1980s. So I'm not saying that you should spank your children. I'm not saying that. My point is this, though. I could say to my friends, my parents did this, my parents did that. However, I have no resentment against my parents whatsoever, because I know I deserved all that. And if anything, I thank God, and I thank my parents for all the feather duster ministry that I received. That's because I know that my parents have the best intention for me, and I know my parents love me 100%. And that's what happens here in verse 18, 19 onwards. Remember my affliction and my wanderings, the wormwood and the gall. My soul continually remembers it and is bowed down within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Jeremiah can say that God did this, God did that. It was terribly painful. However, in the midst of his affliction, in the midst of his painful affliction, when he feels that God is against him, this he calls to mind. He remembers what God is really like. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. God's love, his mercy, his faithfulness, he is my portion, and he is good. Now, we don't have the time to look at each of them. In your own time, in your life group, I encourage you to meditate upon each of God's characters here. But let me highlight just the two of them. Firstly, his mercy. His mercies are new every morning. You know, mercy means that every day, every morning as you wake up, you have new opportunities. You will never run out of second chances. But when we talk about mercy, we don't just talk about mercy when we sin or when we make mistakes. In fact, everything that you receive, everything that you have now is God's mercy. Your health is God's mercy. Your job is God's mercy. Your clothing, your education, your friends, and yes, in fact, your breakfast this morning is God's mercy. We deserve much worse than all that, but God didn't give us what we deserve. That's His mercy. And secondly, His faithfulness. Faithfulness, yes, God's faithfulness means that He will never leave us, He will never forsake us, but His faithfulness also means that He will stay true to His word, which means that God's judgment upon Israel is also part of His faithfulness to His covenant. He said that He will judge them when they were disobedient, and He did. So when He said that He will restore them when they return to Him, they could trust in God's faithfulness on that as well. He is faithful to judge. He is faithful to forgive as well. And if those five characters are not enough, in verses 31 to 39, Jeremiah describes three more things about God. In verses 31, he says that he remembers that God never intends to harm nor to crush his children. It is not in his nature as a loving father to destroy us. In verses 34 to 36, Jeremiah remembers that God hates injustice, that God will uphold his justice in the end, and the perpetrators will answer to him. In verses 37 to 39, Jeremiah remembers that God is in control, that nothing happens in this world that is outside of God's control. God is never caught off guard. So, God is love, God is merciful, God is faithful, God is our portion, God is good, it is never his intention to crush us, God will uphold his justice, God is in total control, and Jeremiah brings all this into mind. And he knows, he remembers that God is behind the suffering, but he also knows that the God who is behind his suffering is the God that he can fully trust. And because of this, instead of running away from God, instead of cursing God, Jeremiah turns to God. And that is my third point. When I feel that God is against me, I remember what it's like, what he is like, and I come to you, Lord, because you are for me. Now, like I said, the sentence doesn't flow naturally. It shifts from the third person, God and he, to the second person, pronoun you. And that's not because of my English. That's quite deliberate, but probably my English as well. But you can see this progression in this chapter. In verses 1 to 18, it's all he and his and I and me and my. And then from the end of verse 18, Jeremiah started to invoke the name of the Lord. Jeremiah started to invoke the name of the Lord. And then verses 42 onwards, Jeremiah addresses God using the second person pronoun, you. God is no longer just a force to reckon with or a being that is spoken using the third person pronoun. God is now a person that Jeremiah can have a relationship with. Instead of allowing the suffering to drive a wedge in his relationship with God, Jeremiah now sees the suffering as a way to strengthen his relationship with God. And Jeremiah does two things. He submits to God in repentance, and he surrenders his right to vengeance. So when we know that God is love, that God is merciful, that God is faithful, that God is good, and when we know that God is a loving Father and a sovereign God of justice, whenever we go through suffering, we do the same two things. We submit to God in repentance. Firstly, we submit to God in repentance. Verse 40 to 42 says, "Let us test and examine our ways and return to the Lord. Let us lift up our hearts and hands to God in heaven. We have transgressed and rebelled, and you have not forgiven." We all know. So the first thing to do is to repent. And we all know that suffering is just wrong. Something in us is telling us that the world is not supposed to be like this. Sickness, COVID, the flood in Eastern Europe. Something in us is telling us that the world is not supposed to be like this. But at the same time, we must not always think that the problem is always out there. You know, in Luke chapter 13, verse 1 to 5, when Jesus was asked about why some people went through the so-called unmerited suffering, Jesus said this, and it's worth quoting all of them. "There were some present at that very time who told him about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And he answered them, 'Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered in this way? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Or those 18 on whom the Tower of Siloam fell and killed them, do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others who lived in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish.'" So Jesus is saying that not all sufferings are caused by specific sins. Sometimes there is no explanation as to why people suffer, or at least we don't know. But Jesus says that our response should still involve
repentance.
So any suffering is God's megaphone to draw our attention. It is God's call to examine our relationship with God and His call to lean closer with Him. We must not think that we are never the culprit in any problems in this world. You and I, we contribute to sufferings in this world. We cause pain and hurt to many people. So therefore, when we see any suffering, we should look to God and repent. So that's the first one. We submit to God in repentance. And secondly, we surrender our right to vengeance. Verse 64 to 66, Jeremiah says, "You will repay them, O Lord, according to the work of their hands. You will give them dullness of heart. Your curse will be on them. You will pursue them in anger and destroy them from under your heavens, O Lord." Friends, we live on this side of the cross, so we no longer pray like this. However, one thing that is true about Jeremiah's prayer is this. He surrenders his right to vengeance. Friends, our desire for vengeance, when you entertain vengeance in your own time, you know, our desire for vengeance actually comes from the right motive. It is our desire for justice. Our desire for justice, it is part of us being made in God's image. However, because of sin, we cannot trust ourselves to execute justice. Therefore, we must leave justice and vengeance to God. Romans 12, verse 19, "Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord.'" And therefore, in Romans 12, Paul says, "Love your enemies. Pray for your enemies." So suffering is an opportunity for us. Suffering is an opportunity for us to have a bigger version, bigger vision of God's justice. A bigger vision of God's justice, and it's an opportunity for us to trust Him, to trust in what God can do, and to trust in who God is. So friends, when we feel that God is against us, instead of cursing Him, instead of cursing our situation, we remember what God is like. And therefore, instead of running away from Him, we come to God in repentance and we surrender our right to vengeance. And we do that because we know that ultimately God is for us and He is not against us. Friends, whether or not you are a Christian, suffering is real. Suffering is real. The Bible is honest about suffering. Everybody suffers. The question is, what is your ultimate hope in the midst of your suffering? Jeremiah lamented over Jerusalem's sins and disobedience, but he couldn't do anything about it. Jesus, on the other hand, he wept over Jerusalem and he went to the cross to die for their sins. Jeremiah felt that God was against him. Jeremiah felt the rod of God's wrath upon him and the nation. But for us who live on the side of the cross, so for us who trust Jesus as our Savior, God is no longer against us. On that cross, Jesus suffered and He took on God's wrath on our behalf. Jeremiah remembered God's love, mercy, faithfulness, and goodness, and on the cross, God's love, God's mercy, God's faithfulness, all of them, and both God's faithfulness to judge and His faithfulness to forgive, all of them met on the cross. Jesus' death on the cross is the ultimate expression of His love for us. However, at the same time, friends, if you have not trusted in Jesus as your Savior just yet, God's wrath is still looming over you. He will uphold His justice. Either you trust in Jesus to suffer God's wrath in your place, or you will suffer God's eternal wrath forever. Trust in Jesus. Don't let this world, don't let the suffering in this world drive you away from God. There's no real hope anywhere else. Instead, let your suffering, let the suffering in this world drive you closer to God. The God who is consistent to bring justice to human evil will also be consistent in his covenant promise to save and to rescue his people from sin, from evil, and from death. And that is our hope, and that is our salvation. Let me pray, and I'll take questions. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, that you allowed Jeremiah to pen this book of Lamentations. It's a hard book to swallow. It's a hard book to accept, especially in the midst of our suffering. But it is honest. We know that it is honest, and we know that in behind all this, Lord, we can look to you as our hope in our affliction. And we thank you, Lord, that the whole Bible shows us that we are sinners, but it shows us that you are good. So help us to cling on to that goodness, cling on to your faithfulness, so that in the midst of our suffering, we will stick with you, we will cling on to you, we will not run away from you, because there is no hope anywhere else. We thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.